Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
It's election night here in Calgary. Federal election is on, and this past week we saw the opposite of what we're seeing in the federal elections when the Reds got beaten handedly by the Blues. As always, it's Dan and Matt back with you, and Matt, we got a lot to talk about this week. How you doing, my friend?
Personally, all right. The Flames, yeah, not so much.
You enjoying watching the election coverage? We talked a bit before we started. It's good. I think it's going to be a pretty interesting election this year.
Yeah, it's looking like it'll be a Liberal majority, which, depending on how you're voting, that's either a good thing or a bad thing.
Yeah, but it's going to mean change in this country, which we have a new party in power here in Alberta. We're going to have a new party in power, it looks like, across Canada. It's going to be an interesting year. So let's start out the show this week with some news from the sick bay. We got some guys going on and some guys coming off. So I think the biggest news that we heard this week was that Lance Boma is injured. He has a broken fibula, and he's going to be out for about 3 months. And, you know, this early in the year, a guy like Boma, who's the energy guy, and looking at the start we have, this could be bad news for the Flames. What do you think, Matt?
Yeah, when I saw the injury happen in the Salad Dome, like, it didn't even look like a particularly bad thing. Like, he just looked like he got hit into the boards and was skating off a little awkwardly. Like, I was expecting, like, maybe he sprained his ankle or something like that, not, you know, he broke his leg. It when it rains, it pours, and, you know, the Flames are having a lot of everything go against them in the early part of the season. Freak injuries to TJ Brody, Joe Colborne, and now Lance Boma. Those are three of your key players, and having all those guys sidelined for a while, it never helps.
You know what, though? If you look at the Flames, usually we get our big kind of injury push, I guess, at the end of the year. And it's usually when we're trying to fight for a playoff spot that we get all our guys injured. So I'm hoping, if it's all happening now, that we can kind of get it out of the way and then play the rest of the season with a fairly healthy team. You know, like Gio got injured end of last year. Usually we see a lot of guys get injured near the end.
Well, one thing that is interesting is last year, right around this time, a lot of the veteran players ended up getting hurt. Like, I recall all three of our centers all went out pretty much in the same game, and that ended up actually sparking the Flames to go on a winning streak, which seems contrary, but, you know, that's what happened. So hopefully the young guys, with Marcus Granlund drawing in, hopefully they can assert themselves more and the Flames can reset themselves moving forward.
So as Matt mentioned, Marcus Granlund draws in the lineup. He got recalled from Stockton. And we talked last week about how we thought that Granlund's probably not sent down to Stockton because he deserved it. It was just a numbers game and he was the guy that didn't have to clear waivers. But I think that we both agreed last week that Granlund deserves to be in the NHL this year. So I think, you know, him coming back, this is going to be his chance to really earn that spot and keep that spot after we get some guys healthy.
Yeah, and realistically, the Flames need to have players like him step up and step into the lineup and take the spot. You know, it's not just good enough that, oh, I can skate in the NHL. You have to, you know, start scoring and generating the offensive chances so that way you can carve out an NHL career instead of being sent back down when whomever it is gets healthy again.
Yeah, and I mean, I think he deserves it. I think he's NHL ready, so I'm hoping that he's not just here to fill in, but I think he's going to have to win a spot. And looking at how long Boma's going to be out, I definitely think that, you know, he's going to have enough work that he can win that spot if he wants to. It's not like they're just bringing him up for two games or three games. But I guess it's going to be a matter of, you know, whose job would he take? He's definitely not going to take Boma's job. So, you know, for him to stick, I think he's going to have to outplay somebody else at their game. And then the question becomes, who takes Boma's job?
Yeah, well,
Or who replaces Boma short-term, I guess.
Yeah, well, I think in this situation that Granlund is competing directly with Mason Raymond.
I think you're right.
And, you know, I'm guessing that a guy like, say, Michael Ferland is going to sort of take on the Boma role.
I think we'll probably see Ferland and maybe even a little bit of Bolig probably share that role. We've already seen Bolig being quite aggressive the last couple games.
Yeah. Well, I know in the Oilers game, Ferland threw quite a few heavy hits.
Yeah, he did.
I know he lined up McDavid at one point, and that's part of what Boma brought last year. So we'll see.
And Ferland's on, what, a one-year deal?
Yeah.
So this could really be Ferland's chance as well to, you know, to show the team that, hey, you know, I can step in there and I can do this as well. And, you know, I really can cement myself. I think last year he was probably sort of in the shadow of Boma a little bit. And maybe this is his chance to step up and show the team that he can take on that role.
Oh, for sure.
As the number one agitator instead of the number two.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I agree with you that I think Granlund's probably competing for Mason Raymond's job. Which, speaking of Raymond, we talked last show about how we saw him really, in the second game of the year, he was on fire. And he looked really good. What have you thought of his performance over the last couple games?
I thought he played well the next game, and then that was pretty much it. And I don't even think I noticed him at all in the Oilers game. It's one of those things that he needs to be consistently good in order to stay in the lineup, and you can't have performances where you're just there, and he was just there in the Oilers game.
Played
and I think
13 and a half minutes in the Oilers game, but yeah, I can't say that I ever remember seeing him either.
Yeah. And it's one of those things that the Flames have a lot of passengers in the early part of this season where, like, especially on each line, there seems to be one guy that's, like, sticking out as being clearly inferior to the other two players on the line. And Raymond has been that third guy on each line thus far this season. You know, that's part of what the why the Flames are struggling is last year that they were able to throw out the first line, but then the second line would give a good effort from all three players, then the third line would give a good effort from all three players. But this year, what you're having is where two of the players on the lines are doing a good job, but then the play dies with the third guy. And it's interrupting the flow because the third guy's turning the puck over. And Raymond has been very prone to turning the puck over.
He has. And that's not something that we've just seen this year. I think that's something we could say about Raymond in general as an NHL player. I think even on the seasons when he's looked really good, he's still always turned over more pucks than he should.
Yes, and the Flames, if they want to reestablish their relentless forecheck, they're going to have to either concentrate those struggling players on the fourth line and just eat their 5 minutes and, you know, like, rely more on the rest of the guys, or start waving and demoting guys or put them in the press box.
You never know. And I mean, we saw guys last year get put in the press box when they didn't have a good game. Weidman, Goudreau were both victims of that, and they came out and played better after that. So, you know, maybe it's not a bad thing to start saying, hey, you know, you need the night off tonight. We have one guy who's going to the injury bay. We have a couple players coming off of that. Joel Colborne is skating again. He had a thumb injury, and he's expected to be back probably this week. And you were mentioning that Coach Hartley said that Ladislav Smid is also coming off the injury reserve. So good to know. Important to know that those guys are coming off the injury reserve as well. Just for as a note, Sam Bennett has been placed on the injury reserve as of the 17th, and he's expected to be out for one game. So he probably won't be playing the game this week against the Capitals, but will be back for the Red Wings. Matt, what do you think? Colborne, he played most of the offseason here. He worked out, he played the preseason. You think he can just step back in the lineup, no problem?
Oh, for sure. And I think he's one of the players that the Flames have been missing.
Yeah.
Him and TJ Brody have been the two guys that were the biggest blows from all the injuries. And Colborne, he is not always the most consistent player, but the Flames have been lacking his size, especially on the forecheck, and he really started to take off with that at the end of last year, and it started becoming more of a strength as he was being more assertive with the puck. And if he can return even tomorrow, that would be a huge boost, so that way the Flames could start attacking with more consistency instead of dumping the puck in, turning it over, and then it's right back out the other way.
Yeah, I think that Colborne's a guy who can step into some of the energy role that Boma has left behind as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that'll definitely help in that respect. Laddie Smead, he's been out since, I believe, since like
December.
December. I was going to say almost this time last year, but yeah, it was December. So he hasn't played the whole calendar year. If he is ready to go, now I haven't heard that he's cleared, medical by the doctor, but let's assume he is ready to go. What do you do with Smead? Do you bring him right back in the lineup? Do you send him to AHL on a conditioning stint? What would you do with him?
I would actually send him to the Stockton Heat just for like two or three games. Not because of his play, but just to get him some actual game action instead of stepping right in, because if he's rusty at all, that's going to be a huge problem,
especially for a team that's still trying to get their footing this year.
Exactly. And you can't have a guy that's turning the puck over because hasn't played in 10 months. So if you could send him to Stockton just for 2, 3, 4 games, let him get his sea legs back under him, then he should be good to go.
And for those that don't know, there is a clause within the central bargaining agreement that says that a club can essentially send a player down for no more than 14 consecutive days if it's a player that's been on a long-term injury, and he does not have to clear waivers to do that. So we're not at a risk of losing Smead. It's just a way to send him down there and get him some games in, which I think that's exactly what I would do, is I'd send him down there. I mean, he hasn't had a training camp. He hasn't played in 10 months. I don't want to put him right back on the ice. I'd send him down for 14 days and get him some time down there, and let's see what he's got and exactly how rusty he is. And then, Matt, do you think that Smead can come back after that conditioning stint and still be a regular, say, 5-6 defenseman, or do you think he'll probably be relegated to the 7-8 role?
Well, I would test him out. He was better than Engelland when he did play last year, and Engelland has kind of struggled a bit in the early going this year. Like, Brett Kulak has actually been a better overall player than Engelland thus far. So I would expect Smead to draw in, see what he's got. If he's okay, then it would depend largely on which guy is doing better when they actually play. It's sort of like the goalie situation. You see who's doing better and you go with the other guy, that guy instead of the other one.
Yeah, Smead is only 29, so he's still a fairly young defenseman. But yeah, I think that you'll see Smead and Kulak and Engelland all kind of fighting for that sixth spot on the defensive core on any given night. And honestly, if I'm kind of hedging my bets, I would like to see Kulak and Smead really fighting for that role, and Engelland to be kind of relegated to the backup defenseman when we need some muscle in the lineup.
I wouldn't even be opposed to using Engelland as a temporary forward if need be as well.
You know what? I don't think that we're in a position, though, where we need to be converting guys from one to the other. If we need a forward, just call somebody up. We've got a ton of them.
Oh, I know. It's just one of those things that it is an option, because he did used to play right wing for the Penguins quite a bit.
Yeah, I don't even think if I was Hartley in his team, I'd even consider it. Like, I think, if you need a right winger, we'll bring one in. We've got enough of them. It's not like we're hurting for wingers.
True enough.
But, you know, I'll give England some credit. I've thought so far in what we've seen from him that he's looked better in the few outings we've seen from him this year than he did for most of last year. But I still think that he's probably, to me, he's the number eight guy on the depth chart.
Yeah, I agree entirely there. That's part of the problem that the Flames are having, is that they have too much money tied up in guys that are just there. And unfortunately, a lot of those players still have another full year after this one on their contract.
Yeah, and I mean, you know, we have to look too at when those were signed and why those were signed. And at the time, it's not that we signed Deryk Engelland to a $2.9 million deal because we necessarily thought he was worth it. I think that really we signed Deryk Engelland to a $2.9 million deal because we had to get to the league minimum.
Yeah, and that the Flames needed some leadership abilities that he does possess. It's just one of those things that now the Flames are poised to take those next steps, and they have a lot of dollars tied up in players that aren't very good.
Well, yeah, if you look on the blue line, we've got Deryk Engelland making $2.9 million this year and next year, and we've got Ladislav Smid making $3.5 million this year and next year. And yet you've got a guy like Chris Russell who's making $2.6 million comparatively, and everyone else is over the $4 million mark, Hamilton, Weidman, Brody, and Geo. So yeah, I definitely think that it's a bit out of proportion there. But I still think like a guy like Engelland, if we keep him around for most of the year, even if we were to, you know, have him clear waivers, let's say, and send him to the AHL, if we were to swallow half of that deal for next year, or even this year and next year, that means he's costing another team $1.5 million. I think you'd still get some takers at $1.5 for him.
Oh, yeah. A lot of teams could use somebody like Engelland for $1.5 million, especially teams like, say, like an Arizona or, you know, insert rebuilding team here. But even at that rate, you might even see the Flames use some buyouts, which is never the most ideal situation. It's one of those things that it really depends on in how much of a crunch they are this time next year.
Well, I always look at it that you probably want to generally carry seven defensemen. You play six, you sit one, you don't want to have two guys sitting. So if I look at the eight that we have, and let's assume that it's the same eight defensemen on the roster now at, say, the trade deadline, just, you know, to make it easy. I think that you could find a buyer at the trade deadline for $1.5 million for this year and next year for Engelland, or $1.75 million this year and next year for Smid, no problem. So I think if you need to flip one of those guys, it would be fairly easy to do so.
You wouldn't be getting much for it, but you could do it.
But you would clear some salary. I mean, that's, say, $1.5 million that now we could use to put towards Russell.
Yeah, exactly. Because
if Russell's making 2.6 and all our other defensemen are over $4 million, I would imagine Russell's going to expect a deal in about the $3 million range. So that's $1.5 million that we could use for Russell. Kulak, can he still clear waivers? Or, sorry, is he waiver exempt, I should ask?
Yeah, he's good for another, I think, 2 years. Unless he plays like almost all this season, because there's a games played thing.
So really, I mean, what we might end up seeing, realistically, as much as I don't think it's necessarily the best move, is we'll probably see Smid sent down to the AHL for his 14 days, get his conditioning stint, come back up and send Kulak down and carry seven veteran defensemen.
Yeah, I could see that.
And then it would be up to, you know, one of the farm guys, be it Kulak or Anderson or Shillington or Morrison or somebody else, to win one of those jobs. But just looking at the salary structure of our defensemen, I think that you're going to see Hamilton, Weidman, Brody, Giordano, Smid, Engelland, and Russell as the seven guys here, unless we get an injury.
Yeah, and the Flames may have to look at dealing some of the 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 guys, but those things will come up as the season progresses, and a lot will depend on if the Flames play better. Like, if the Flames say they continue to struggle and it's January and like the Flames are 28th or whatever, then, you know, you're going to be more prone to, say, trading a guy like Russell or, you know, some of the other guys like Weidman, Engelland, Smid, and just clear their contracts out entirely.
See, but I don't think any of those are bad contracts. Like, if I look at a Russell deal at 2.6 or even a Weidman deal at 5.2, it's not,
but
not a bad deal.
You say, yeah, well, it's one of those things that you, if the Flames are struggling and are looking like a lottery pick team, that changes things a little bit, because you can,
if they're doing that poorly, yeah, but if they're just, you know, say below, let's say the 9 to 11 in the West, you've got to hang on to the assets you have.
Yeah, I'm saying, like, if the Flames are like way out of it though, like Edmonton territory from last year,
well, let's hope that doesn't happen.
Oh no, but in a situation like that, then you're going to be looking to maximize whatever assets that you can.
Well, yeah, I think if we're that far out, we're going to see some forwards moving too. You know, I think you'd see Backlund, Stajan, guys like that move.
Anybody that's not stapled down, see you later.
And you know, I think that that's definitely when you might make some wholesale changes. But looking realistically at where the team probably will be, I think that if any one of the two is going to move, it would probably be England.
Yes.
I think the teams are probably going to be reluctant to deal for Smid, considering he's been out for a year.
Yeah, and his injury is one of those that one solid check, and that might be it for his career. So that's another worry, and like if I was another team, I wouldn't want to touch Smid just for that reason. Like, it's one thing if you're signing him to like a PTO. It's another if you're, you know, spending at least 1.75, probably more, for 2 years. Like, that's, you know, I wouldn't touch that one.
My guess, and I don't want to sound like I'm a pessimist, but I have a feeling that Smid is not going to remain healthy all year. I think that either the same injury is going to act up again or another injury, and I don't think we're going to have much playtime out of him. And as much as I hate to say it, because he's only 29, I think this might be his last season as an NHL player. Like, if he gets hurt again and it's a long term, I think, you know, the Flames probably would say, you know what, we probably can't re-sign you. I don't think anyone else would. He might just end up retiring. And I hate to say that, but I don't think that, I don't, just my heart is telling me that he probably won't be healthy for the majority of the year.
And we hope that that's not the case.
Oh, of course. Just looking at how long he's been out, and generally when you see guys that are out this long, they don't have a lot of longevity after an injury like that.
No, and the fact that he got hurt last year, then he came back for like 2 games, got hit again, and then has been out ever since. Like,
and the Flames' style is going to put him in harm's way. I mean, you can't really protect, you can't protect a defenseman from taking those big hits. That's what's required to wear a Flaming C.
I know. It's not like the Flames are a passive team. We're one of the more physical teams in the NHL. So it's one of those, you can't insulate the guy. And unfortunately, if he gets hit the wrong way, that'll be it for his NHL career, which you never want to see.
No, and I'm not saying I hope that by any means, but just being...
No, of course
just
not.
My,
you're a human being.
My prediction is that he's... I don't think he's going to make it past... If he does make it past this year, I don't think that he will get another NHL contract after next year. But it's just in my heart, I'm kind of, I don't think he's going to be playing for us more than, say, 30 games this year. And I think he might just end up calling it quits.
Yeah, stick through the remainder of the contract to get the extra $3.5 million, and maybe take a contract in Europe where the game's a lot less physical.
Well, I can also see Smid. I mean, from what I understand, he's a fairly good mind for the game, and he's a fairly good leader. I could see him taking a coaching position somewhere. You know, I could
definitely.
I could see him maybe not even finishing the contract, but just retiring next year and maybe joining the Flames organization as a coach. You know, almost like we saw Conroy retire and rejoin us. But I just, yeah, I think that you're gonna see Smid around pro hockey for a while. But I mean, really, if you look, he got traded to the Flames in 2013-2014. He played 56 games. Last year, he played 31 games. So this guy's played almost just over a full season for us in 2 years. So it's not like he's, you know, an Iron Man there. And if we look back at his stats when he worked with the Oilers, the most games he ever played was 78. 2 years in a row, 77. He had a 65 game year, a 60 game, a 51 game year, a 48 game year. So he's not a guy that is an Iron Man. And I think, you know, if you're the Flames and you're looking at long term, that might factor in there too. So I'd have to go back and see if he was injured those years or scratched or what was going on, but leads me to believe he was probably hurt for most for part of those years.
Yeah, well, his neck injury did happen while he was with the Oilers.
I have a bad feeling that we've pretty much seen the last of Ladislav Smid as a Calgary Flames player. I hope I'm wrong. There's one prediction I hope in our year-end wrap-up we can look at and say Dan was wrong. But I just have a funny feeling that he's done. Well, Matt, the big, I guess, the elephant in the room this year so far, and we'll talk about it after this week. We're five games into the season now. We're expecting the Flames to come out hot. And here we sit on the 19th of October, and we have a 1-4 record. So we've won one game, we've lost four, we lost pretty much every game except for the second game to Vancouver. So we lost the home opener 5-1. We beat Vancouver 3-2 in the second game. We lost 4-3 against St. Louis. We lost 3-1 against Winnipeg, and the one that hurts the most, we lost 5-2 to Edmonton. So why don't we spend some time talking about this last week's games first. Any thoughts you had about the last week of games?
I thought that with how they played, they should not have walked away with 0 points. Yes, they played terrible against the Oilers, pretty much from the puck drop till the final buzzer. But against both St. Louis and Winnipeg, they were pretty good all the way throughout those games.
I thought they could have won the St. Louis game.
I thought they could have won the Winnipeg game, too. It's just unfortunate puck luck ended up being the downfall.
Yeah, see, I thought at the beginning they were looking good against Winnipeg. I think that as the score started mounting, we saw the team get a bit frustrated. And I think by the end of the game, we weren't seeing the Calgary Flames playing their game.
Yeah, well, they should have made it at least to overtime.
Yeah, you'd think so. But you could see kind of as the game went on that their game was starting to deteriorate a little bit.
True enough.
And then that Edmonton game, I mean, I don't know what it was, but that was terrible.
It's the first time since 2000-2001 that the Flames have dropped their first three home games.
Wow.
So, you know, you're talking middle of the Young Guns era.
Yeah.
So, you know, this start is just that great.
No, I mean,
so, not good.
To be fair, historically, we're not a good team in October. Usually we're not this bad, but we're not a good team in October.
Yeah, well, last year the Flames were only 6-5, and they didn't look particularly good. It wasn't until we ran into those injury troubles that the Flames actually ended up taking off.
Yeah, I think, you know, and I think last year was some different circumstances too, because we had a lot of younger guys, and, you know, they're trying to find their way around the roster, and, you know, to me, there was that adjustment period that was needed, which this year, I don't think we have the same excuse.
No. And realistically, the main reason why the Flames have struggled to start is that there's no cohesion in the line. Like, Hartley was saying, like, he was wanting to get twosomes on each line, and that has worked. Those two players on each line are working well together. It's just the third guy on the line, with the exception of Hudler, has really been out of sorts with the other two guys to the point where there's very little chemistry at all, and they're not getting any flow consistently through the game. There might be the odd good shift here and there, but it's hard to push the puck up if your second, your third, and your fourth line are having a hard time even controlling the play.
And, you know, I understand what Hartley's trying to do, and, you know, maybe I'm traditional, maybe I'm too old school, but to me, a forward line is three guys, and you really want to be making your lines of three guys, because even if you have two, it's tough to, you know, switch that last guy out and still have the chemistry. And, you know, last year we saw great chemistry from Monahan, Gaudreau, and Hudler, and I think that, you know, we can definitely get threesomes in sync and just hope that there's not a lot of injuries and changes to those.
Like, I'm of the opinion that it wouldn't necessarily be a bad idea to bring up a guy like Bill Arnold, who is very cerebral and knows how to play with other players.
Who would you take out of the lineup, then?
Mason Raymond. The Flames only, I do believe, have 22 or 21 players on the roster right at the moment, so, like, they wouldn't necessarily need to send anybody down. It's just having another guy in there that's useful I think, would help. Because I think one of the main problems is that the veteran guys that are on the depth chart are not playing very well. That's part of the reason why the Flames are struggling quite a bit, is that they're not skating as well as they should be. They're not in the right places that they should be. And it was when those veteran guys went down last year that the Flames ended up taking off.
Yeah, and, you know, I agree with you that the veterans aren't looking as good as they could, but I don't think it's just the veterans we can, you know, blame this on. I mean, to me, I look at guys like Josh Juris hasn't been all that impressive. You know, Michael Ferland, I think, has left some things to be desired so far. You know, even Kulak, as good as he's looked, you know, I think that, and, it's easy to say because he's been a 5'6 guy, but I think that he's looked like the rest of the defensive corps. Not like he's been the only shining star there.
You look at yesterday's game against the Oilers, or Saturday's game against the Oilers, you had Juris and Granlund out together. And when they were together, they were playing, like, when they were passing the puck amongst each other, they were doing a good job. The problem is that the third guy on that line was Brandon Bolig. Well, if you're defending them, you just attack those two guys because you know Bullock can't do anything offensively. And that's basically what the Oilers did anytime that line was out there, was swarm the two players that could play. Play's dead. The Flames need to have a third guy to go with the young players. Like, that's where it's difficult to lay the blame of, oh, well, Juris and Granlund didn't produce, but if you're not putting them in a place to actually succeed...
Yeah, I agree.
It's one of those where, you know, it's like having Mason Raymond with Backlund and Frolik. Well, Backlund and Frolik were doing good, but they would pass the puck over to Raymond and he'd turn it over. Well, you know, that's not on the other two guys, that's on Raymond.
I was actually quite liking what I was seeing from the Backlund and Frolik pairing, but I think they need another winger on that line, because that's probably what will end up being our second line, and to me, Mason Raymond has not earned that.
Like, that's why I think, like, a guy like Granlund would actually slot in on that line rather effectively, because Frolik can play either wing, and I think Granlund can play either wing as well, so... You can figure something out, and I think finding the right fits for players to put them in the best position to actually be successful is the next order that the Flames need to do.
Yeah, I could also see, with Joel Colborne coming back, them trying Colborne on that line as well.
Oh, sure. And, like, I could see Colborne playing on a handful of lines. It just depends on what format you're wanting to go with it. Like a Ferland Colborne Jones line might make some sense.
Yeah, it might not be too bad. You know, even I think Jones would be a better choice on the Frolik Backlund line than Raymond.
Pretty much anybody would.
So, Matt, in your opinion right now, has Mason Raymond run out of chances? Is it pretty much at the point where you either relegate him or sit him and bring a kid into his lineup spot?
I'm getting to the point where you just banish him to Stockton, never to see him again, and buy him out in the offseason. It's unfortunate, but he's played himself out of a position, in my opinion. Like, this is a do or die for his NHL career, and you put up the 5 games that he has, you move on. It's, you know, it's like with Devin Setoguchi last year. They gave him enough opportunities. He didn't perform. Now he's playing in Europe. And Mason Raymond, you know, I don't mind Raymond as a player, but he hasn't performed. You have way too many forwards that should be in the NHL in the organization as it is. You can't hold on to somebody that not very good and not really doing anything for your team. And especially with a 1-4 start, like, there's really no, you know, you need to turn around the season. And having a guy that's struggling as much as him, sorry, somebody's got to go.
We have 2 games this week and 7 more this month. I don't see him lasting 7 more games here. And it's not like being banished means he can never be brought back up if he's not looking good down in Stockton. But to me, I would be surprised if he makes it to the New York road trip.
Yeah, so would I
think you might see him given one more game either against the Capitals or the Red Wings here at home. You know, maybe the coaches are trying to motivate him this weekend and saying, hey, you know, we're giving you one more game. This is your do or die. You know, if you don't look good, we have a ticket to Stockton waiting in your stall and seeing what he can do. I think you're going to see him in one of the two, not both games. And if he's still playing like he is, I think we'll see him in Stockton by the 25th.
You've got Kenny Agostino, Bill Arnold, Emile Poirier that are all ready right now to play in the NHL. Not counting a guy like Drew Shore or Morgan Klimchuk, who could also play.
I don't even know if I'd bring somebody up at this point. I'd probably just activate Colborne from the IR and see how we run with that.
The Flames do have guys that could presently step in and play. And if you're not taking a roster spot, then there's somebody in Stockton that's saying, well, I'm good to go. Give me a shot.
Yeah, no, I think you're right. And, you know, just because Mason Raymond gets sent down to Stockton doesn't mean he's banished forever. I mean, if we see him go down there and he tears it up, you pull him back up.
Oh, exactly. Like, if he goes down and scores, like, 10 goals in 15 games, sure, come back up.
At least for another shot.
But you have to earn it, just like anybody else would. It's sort of like Sven Berchi last year. Like, he got sent back down and then he sucked. Now he's playing for Vancouver.
So, yeah, I definitely think you're right. I definitely think Mason Raymond is the bubble guy. And, you know, even the Flames making that kind of a move might sort of motivate the team as well. You know, here we've officially made a veteran lose their job, essentially. We've sent him down to Stockton. Who's next?
Exactly. And don't be comfortable, because you shouldn't be. You know, the Flames have expectations of being a good playoff caliber team, not where Edmonton was last year. Like, right now, only the Columbus Blue Jackets are behind the Flames. Like, that, there's a problem there.
Yeah, but, you know, to be fair, though, Anaheim's 1 point above us.
Oh, yeah. I'm not saying the other teams aren't struggling. Like, Los Angeles has been terrible as well to start. You can't accept being a loser. And thus far, the Flames have been losers to start the season. Like, even the one game that they did win, it was a third period comeback, and like they played like crap in the second period and could have easily lost that game as well. They need to be better.
To me, I think you're right about the lines needing to be solidified. I know we've seen Hartley like to tinker with the lines a lot last year, but I think you, at least your top two lines, I think need to be a solid 3-3. You need to know who those top two are. I'd even argue your top three lines, and you can sort of tinker with the bottom one. But I also think that the biggest issue I'm seeing is the level of effort. I mean, you look at that Edmonton game, that had nothing to do with lines. That was just a terrible effort. And yeah, it was the second night of a back-to-back, but it shouldn't have got away from us like it did.
No. And like, you even saw pretty much right from the get-go, like they couldn't even string a pass together.
Yeah, I know.
For like the first like 10 minutes. And it's like, guys, what are you doing?
And I think, like, even at the end of the Jets game, we saw the Flames do what they've done so often in previous years, where they just get behind and they give up. And I think that we need really to be playing 60 minutes of hockey, or this season's not going to go well if we're just giving up because we're behind. I mean, 3-1 is something you could have come back.
Well, even, like, at the second intermission, wasn't it 2-1? And then they scored two goals right off the bat. Well, a one-goal deficit, especially against Edmonton, give me a break. That could have easily been a 5-2 win for Calgary. But they came out extremely flat. Like, Taylor Hall nearly scored in the first shift. He fired one right off the post, and then he scores 20 seconds later. If the first opportunity didn't wake you up, you know, it's not a good excuse for giving up the goal like 20 seconds after.
Yeah, in the Winnipeg game, it was a 1-1 tie after two, and then Winnipeg got two goals in the third period. In the Edmonton game, it was 2-1 Edmonton at the end of the second, and then they got three quick goals in the third. So, yeah, I think that we're seeing the team giving up in the third and not, you know, being able to play through the 60 minutes. And that's going to be the most important thing, especially if you want to beat some of the powerhouses in the NHL, who some of them don't even get going until halfway through the second. And our problem was the opposite last year, if you remember, is we would have terrible first periods and we'd get down like 3-4 goals. And then we come back and, you know, about halfway through the second, we'd make up the time.
Like, if you look at the five games, in the first Vancouver game, the Winnipeg game, and the Edmonton game, there was maybe 10 minutes in each of those games where the Flames were actually playing decently. And the rest of the 50 minutes was either, you know, being equivalent or getting hammered. You can't play 10 minutes of hockey and expect to win unless you're scoring like 4 goals in that 10 minutes. Like, even in the Vancouver game that they won, they played just okay in the first period. They got shell-shocked in the second and then finally awoke in the third, and it was much the same in the St. Louis game. They just have to be more consistent and better all the way around.
The third thing that I would say they probably need to work on, at least in my view, is I think we need to figure out who the starting goaltender is. I think this flip-flopping of goaltenders, and I mean, we haven't even seen Ortio yet, but we're kind of flip-flopping goalies still, I think is hurting us. And we need to give one guy the job and kind of go from there, you know, and say, okay, this is your net to lose.
Yeah, well, this three-headed monster situation needs to end by the time the Flames leave Calgary for the New York trip.
Yeah, but I think even if you have three guys here, if that's the necessity, you have to give one of them the net. I mean, if we can't make a trade, I don't want them to end it just to end it. But, you know, we have to say, okay, going on the road, maybe this is Ramo's net and it's his to lose, you know?
Well, the problem is, I think they were trying to do the same thing as last year, where if you struggled, the other guy went in. It's just that both of them have struggled, and they're all letting in bad goals. Ortio hasn't even gotten an opportunity yet.
Do you think we might see Ortio play in either of the home games this week?
I'm hoping that he does. With both the other guys struggling, I'd like to see Ortio be able to try and come in and say, well, these guys aren't doing it, I'm taking the job. But unfortunately, the Flames haven't been willing to go that direction because they're trying to find a way to trade one of the other two guys.
Yeah, I think at some point, though, I mean, you have to give Ortio the start. And I mean, if we look at Ortio's past NHL work, he's always looked phenomenal. And, you know, I think even if you've shopped them this long, I think by this point, you know who your buyers are. And if we haven't done a deal with Buffalo yet, I don't think we're doing a deal with Buffalo. So I think we're back to the drawing board of waiting for someone to, you know, need a goalie. And to me, you got to start Ortio and see what you've got. And just like we were talking about with sending Raymond down, it's, you know, hey, we have two veterans here and they got, you know, they're both of them lost their jobs to the kid. So now you guys are going to have to fight to get your net back. And I think that's the kind of competition we need to instill in this team.
Yeah.
And, you know, we've got two games this week, and then we have a back-to-back in New York. So I would almost like to see Ortio at least get a shot. I mean, we can't do any worse than we have been doing, you know. We have to give Ortio a shot at some point and say, okay, you know, maybe he's as terrible as the other goalies, maybe not. But, hey, we got to win. Okay, let's keep him in and, you know, let him play until he loses at least. I don't know. I think that I'm not saying he's our savior or that he's going to turn everything around, but I think at this point you have to make some sort of change, and he's the obvious change. He's the only guy that hasn't played yet.
Exactly. Something's got to change. Like how the Flames last year would pull the goalie if they gave up 3 goals, and it would kind of like snap them into playing better. I think they need to figure out how to do something to like shock the system back into proper alignment.
Well, at this point, to me, Ramo's been the better of the two goalies. I don't know what you think.
Yeah, he's let in a couple of bad goals,
but every goalie
does. Hiller's been consistently mediocre.
And so I think if you give the net to Ortio to try it, and he plays well, let's say against the Capitals, and you make Ramo his backup, you give Ortio the net again then against the Red Wings, you make Ramo his backup, give Ramo one of the two New York games, and now you've got Ramo in that competitive spot again where we've seen him do so well. And I think that's where you might say, okay, you really want to see what we've got from Ramo, whether you're looking to keep him or trade him. This is how we're going to get him to do that.
Yeah.
To me, you have to play Ortio in the next week.
Yeah, and the Flames really do need to get back in the win column, because if the Flames continue to struggle and lose, even say they go 500 the rest of the month, like, they're going to be looking like they're going to be out of a playoff spot already, and it's October. You know, they need to pick it up and fast. Like, I know it's early, and, oh, it's only 5 games in, but
Yeah, I'm not saying the sky's falling yet, but you have to start getting your pace figured out. And
yeah, because then you're going to need to play at like 110 point pace the rest of the way. And like, you know, that's not likely.
To me, we can afford to be, you know, 1-4 so far, but we can't afford to say end October at this pace and be, we can't afford to be like 2-13 by the end of the month.
No.
I think if you let the whole month go by and you can't be at least close to 500, we're going to, like you said, have issues later on when it comes to making some of those points up.
No, because then like in November, you're going to have to win out basically in order to get back into things, and fat chance.
And, you know, it's one of those things too, that if you're playing that close to, you know, the 500 line in November, December, one injury or one, you know, bad move, whether it's a trade or an injury or something like that, that sets the team back, it could be a disaster.
The margins get slimmer and slimmer the longer this persists.
I'm not too worried so far. I mean, we're only 5 games in.
It sounds like, oh, the sky is falling. It's not that. It's just, you really do have to snap out of it right now.
We have 7 games left until Halloween. We play on Halloween in Edmonton. And I think these next 7 games are really going to kind of show us what the Flames are made of. If they can respond to this and say, hey, we lost to Edmonton.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we have to go out and show better. And I think it's also for the coaches and management to make some hard decisions and say, like you said, send Raymond down. Or give Ortio the net, at least for one game. You know, we're not making trades here where we can't undo them, but let's try something different. Maybe it is calling someone like Bill Arnold up and saying, okay, you know, he's been good so far. He's going to get a shot until someone else can prove themselves. But I think we have to do something different because obviously what's happening now isn't working.
When your back's up against the wall a bit, that's the perfect opportunity to make changes. And what's the worst thing that can happen? You continue to struggle. Well, you're already struggling, so what's the difference?
And I mean, just looking at the stats and seeing Calgary and Anaheim at the bottom of the Western Conference, you know, I don't know. I don't want to say it gives me hope, but it shows that we're not the only team that's having a hard time. And I don't think we're going to see a draft lottery that has Calgary, Columbus, and Anaheim as the first 3 teams picking. So I think it's going to turn around. I just really want it to happen soon.
Exactly.
Unless there's anything else about this week you want to talk about, I figure we should probably move on to a bit of a happier note and talk about some of the excellent work being done by some of the prospects.
Please do.
So let's start with some of the, I guess, the guys that are doing really well. Andrew Mangiapane. We talked to him in the preseason during the rookie camp, and he looked pretty good during the rookie camp. And I think for a guy who was drafted as late as Mangiapane was, which was a 6th-round pick, he's going to be a pleasant surprise for this organization, I think, in the long run. So far for the Barrie Colts of the OHL, he has 9 games played, 4 goals and 5 assists, which gives him 9 points. So he's at a point-per-game clip already, which, you know, to me, in the OHL especially, which is a tough league, that's impressive.
Yeah, and he needs to build on his stats from last year. I think he had over 100 points last year, so he needs to get up over that mark again.
Yeah, and I mean, it's still early, but being on that kind of clip early in the year is always promising. And even if if you can get up on that kind of clip and then you falter a little bit, it gives you a little bit of a cushion.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Guy that we get a chance to watch here is Pavel Kharnikov, who plays with the Hitmen. He's played 9 games and has 5 points so far, and 19 penalty minutes. He's been a bit of an aggressor on the ice. So if you get a chance to go see a Hitmen game, don't forget that Kharnikov is now Flames property. So definitely check him out. And we've also seen Mark Jankowski, who is still at college. He's playing at Providence College, and he has 7 points in 3 games. I was actually able to watch a Providence College game this year, and Jankowski's looking, I think, so far from what I've seen, based on the games I saw of his last year, he's looking like he's almost ready to turn pro. This guy's got 5 assists and 2 goals in 3 games. That's quite a pace to be going on. I mean, yeah, it's early. It's 3 games in, but
watched him back in July. We were both remarking on like how good he was, and he was
usually, the college guys tend to be about a step behind everybody else.
Yeah, but he was the best of the forwards at least other than maybe Sam Bennett. So he was very noticeable doing things well at both ends of the ice. So his fast start, he's second in the NCAA in points to start the year. That's not really that much of a surprise based on the step that he took from last year to this year at the development camp. He's looking more comfortable in his body and more used to being a 6'3" player and just generally better overall.
Yeah, I think that's a good way to put it. I saw some of his games last year and he seemed like he didn't really understand his body. I know it sounds like he's hit puberty or something, but he'd grown a lot, and I think that he just hadn't come to terms with what he could and couldn't do with his body. And, you know, sometimes I think that he'd trip over his feet a little bit, or his arms would be bigger than he expected. Almost, and again, I hate to say it, but almost like a Dumbo of, you know, his ears were kind of flapping around. He didn't know how to control them.
I'm oddly enough, when I was like 17, 18, like I had a very similar growth spurt going from 5'6 to 6'3. And it took me till I was 21, 22 to not be pretty much constantly tripping over my own feet. It does throw you off because your mind doesn't know where your limbs are, which doesn't make a lot of sense. It didn't really surprise me that it took Jankowski a while to figure things out because it does really throw you for a loop.
Yeah, and I think it's not just knowing where your limbs are, but I mean, you're so used to, you know, knowing how much clearance you have with your arms or your legs, and when those are growing, you know, sometimes when you make a move, you're expecting you might clear the guy and you don't. And just little things like that where, you know, sometimes I think you can see these guys who are a little bit awkward, and it's just because they have to come to grips with, okay, my arm is now this long, or, you know, I'm not as heavy as I used to be because I've grown 4 inches, so I can't throw myself around like I used to, that sort of thing.
It's all a big adjustment period. That's why, like, he's in his last season in the NCAA, and, like, he's now just finally starting to get comfortable with himself and break out.
But just wanted to point some of those out. There's a lot of guys that don't have any points yet, but, you know, everyone's kind of less than 10 games in every league, so I'm not too worried about that. We have guys like Tim Harrison who have no points, Brandon Hickey who have no points, so guys that I'm not really all that concerned about because, you know, less than 10 games in, it's tough to judge.
Exactly. If they're struggling at the end of the year, then that's a different story.
Or I think even if we were to look at them, you know, this time next month and see some of these guys still pointless, we might be worried.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, 3-4 games in, there's really not a lot to worry about. But just wanted to point out, you know, some of the guys that were doing really well, compliment them on, you know, Jankowski getting 7 points in 3 games, Monjapan going point per game. Those are really promising for the Flames. And, you know, a lot of people thought Jankowski wouldn't pan out as a prospect. And I'm not saying he's necessarily going to be, you know, the next Johnny Gaudreau, but I think that we're going to see this guy make a pretty convincing point that he deserves at least to be, you know, a top-line AHL guy.
Yeah, and if he can figure it out and make the NHL next year, that would be great as well. And, like, anytime you can get a 6'3", 6'4" center that can play decently at both ends of the ice, that every team could use more of that.
And if we can get, you know, we were talking a couple weeks ago about 6th-round picks and what we, you know, what we think they're worth and what we've got there. I think if Monjapan can pan out, you know, even to be anywhere close to a point of game player, even at the AHL level, we've got a heck of a 6th-round pick there.
Definitely.
So good to see those guys doing well. I'll be really curious to see how Stockton's doing. I think that they've got quite a good roster this year from front to back. I think last year the defense was the gaping hole, and I wouldn't be surprised if Stockton was challenging for the Calder Cup this year.
Well, one of the interesting problems that Stockton had in the second game was the veteran players were actually the worst players. Sort of like what happened in Calgary. So, you know, it'll be interesting to see if the veteran players can contribute like they should in the AHL, because usually teams that are veteran-laden tend to be the better ones.
But, you know, again, it's only one game, and, you know, hopefully they'll pick it up, go from there, and both teams will turn around, I'm hoping. You know, everybody loses a game. Everybody has a game where they look bad, so I'm not too worried about the Stockton Vets not looking good for one game. All right, so the last piece we have to do is, as always, we have to look at the predictions for the coming week. Looking back at last week, we had 6 points on the table. We thought that they would probably get 4 points. We both thought 4 points, but we thought 4 points differently. You thought they'd beat the Oilers and the Blues, and I thought they'd beat the Jets and the Oilers. And neither one of us was right. We ended up getting skunked, and we got 0 of the 6 points.
Yeah, that was a disappointing week for everybody involved.
Feels terrible, doesn't it?
Oh, I know. The shame of losing to Edmonton, most of all. Just terrible.
Yeah, it was. Hopefully it's going to snap them out of it. So looking ahead, we got 4 games for a record next. We'll record next Tuesday. So we have this week coming in as home games. We have a 2-game homestand. We have Tuesday night, the Washington Capitals. That's 7 o'clock start time. And then we have a 2-day break before we see another Eastern Conference team, the Detroit Red Wings, at 7 o'clock. Then the Flames go on the first 2 of their 3-game away trip. And they're going to New York State. Sunday night, they're in Manhattan, where they play the Rangers. And Monday, they travel to the new arena in Brooklyn, where they will be playing against the Islanders. So, Matt, 4 points, or 4 games, 8 points on the table. How do you think we're going to do this week?
I think they will get 4 points. I think they'll beat the New York Islanders and the Detroit Red Wings. I think they're going to have a tough time with both the Washington Capitals and the New York Rangers.
So you're thinking that they're going to get 4 of the possible 8.
Yeah. I think they usually struggle against both the New York Rangers in Madison Square Garden and against the Washington Capitals, at least historically. Like, I know that usually it's Alexander Ovechkin that does a lot of damage against the Flames. And then they've since added TJ Oshie, who used to be a real thorn in our side for the St. Louis Blues, so...
We still couldn't beat the Blues even without Oshie there, though.
No, but at least, now he's on the Capitals, so we're going to have 2 players that we have difficulty with. And then we also face the New York Rangers, who I do believe we got shut out last year against them, and we just, for whatever reason, struggle in that building.
If I'm looking at these 4 games, I think we're going to lose against the Capitals. I think we're going to have a hard time against the Red Wings. I think we might be lucky to sneak away with overtime loss or a shootout loss, get 1 point there. I think that we'll struggle against the Rangers. And if historically, you know, we look at the second game of a back-to-back, which I guess the only one we've had so far is the Oilers game, I think we're going to lose there too. But my guess is, I don't want to be a pessimist, but I'm thinking that we might get 3 points this week.
Yeah, it could happen that way.
I think we can probably sneak away with 1 point against the Red Wings, and I think we might be able to get 2 against the Islanders.
Yeah, it's one of those situations where the Flames are going to have to change a lot of how they're playing in order to get more than 3 or 4.
Yeah, I think 4 is going to be a stretch. To even go 500 this week is going to be a stretch. They're tough teams and not the teams you want to face when you're trying to rebound.
Yeah, like if they continue to play as they have through the first 5, they might go 0-4. That's how tough the teams are that they're facing. So I'm hoping that they bounce back, but it's going to be on them.
Yeah, we'll see. Not really the teams I was hoping to try and snap this streak against, but you got to play the hand you're dealt, and it's going to be tough, but I think we might see it, especially with the road trip and then having a day off before we go to Ottawa. I think you might see the team start to bond a little bit on the road trip, and hopefully as soon as we see the guys go away and they're in the hotels and they're hanging out as a line more, that might help snap some of this too. Do you think we see Ortio in net in any of these 4 games?
I'm hoping that they put him in. Honestly, I was hoping that he would have started against Edmonton just because the other 2 goaltenders have struggled thus far. We'll see. I'm hoping that the goaltending problem gets sorted out before they go on the New York road trip.
My bet is that they start Hiller or Rama, whoever's turn it is, Tuesday against the Capitals. I think that they'll start
Rama.
Okay, so they'll probably start Rama Tuesday. I bet they start Ortio on Friday if they still lose against the Red Wings. And then Hiller in the first game in New York and Ortio in the second game in New York.
Yeah, I can see that.
So that way every goalie gets to play once in the next three games, and then Ortio gets the second of the back-to-back. That's my estimation.
Yeah. Well, I'm just hoping that by the end of this month that the Flames only have two goaltenders in the NHL, and that's it, instead of, you know, this whole problem of three people and trying to figure out which guy to go with.
Yeah, at the same time, I don't want them to make a trade just to make the trade. If it's right, I think you make it, but if it's not, you know, I don't want us just to get rid of one of them. I think you might have to hang on to the three of them a little bit longer to get a good deal. But I would have no qualms about sitting either Rama or Hiller in the press box.
Yeah, the problem with that is that you're going to be reducing the value and effectiveness of all three guys if you carry this on for too much longer, because everybody needs to play at some point. And like, you can't have one guy playing every third game, like all three of them. That would be a little... Like, especially if one of them, say, like, Ortio comes in and, like, throws a shutout out there.
Well, if somebody gets hot, then you obviously give them the job. But even looking next week, where we have three games in 4 days, where we're playing, you know, back-to-backs New York and then one in Ottawa, I could definitely see giving each goalie a start there.
True.
You know, then we have another back-to-back Friday, Saturday. Like, I think over this five-game period, you have to give everybody a start. And you just go from there. I just don't want them to make a move just to go, well, we need to get rid of a goalie just to do it. I want them to, you know, make the move when it's the right time.
Mm-hmm.
And we can get the maximum value back.
True.
We got injuries now. We've got the roster space. We might as well carry all three.
Doesn't hurt. Just hope. I'm just hoping that there's a conclusion to this goalie saga sooner than later. That's all.
Yeah, no, I agree with you, but I think as long as we start getting Ortio some games and we can see what he can do,
yeah,
that's the important thing
I'm concerned about. Like, if we leave Ortio on the sidelines until November, like, how sharp is he going to be once he actually gets in?
With 5 games in 7 days coming up next week, I think you're going to see that he has to play at least one.
Yeah.
You know, we have two back-to-backs in a one-week period. It would be foolish for the coaching staff, especially if we keep losing, not to try him out. I mean, you can't get any worse than you are.
Yeah.
Yeah, and, you know, the one thing I will say that is good about the Flames right now, with even where they are sitting, is it seems like everybody is fairly upbeat about it. Bob Hartley held a fairly upbeat practice, very light practice today at the Dome. You know, you'd have a lot of coaches that might bag skate their team after 5-2 loss to the Oilers, but it looks like... you know, it looks like everyone's kind of taking it in stride and realizing that we are only 5 games in. So I'm glad to see that. I'm glad that nobody in the organization is thinking the sky is falling yet.
If this was like 10 or 15 games in and they were still playing like this, then yeah, you start yelling at them a little bit more aggressively.
And we play against the Oilers on Halloween, and I wouldn't be surprised if the coaching staff is telling the team, you know, this is our chance for redemption. You know, this is where we can come back and say, you guys
and
got the better of us.
And the Oilers are going to be dressed up like pumpkins that night, so they are...
You think they'll wear their orange jerseys?
Oh, I know.
I hate those jerseys.
Saw way too many of them at the Dome on Saturday.
You know, I don't know why people would buy those and wear them in public. You know, I saw them at the draft and I thought, okay, you know, it's interesting, it's different. That's sort of their old WHA uniform. But, you know, when I saw them on the ice, I'm like, this is terrible. I wasn't a huge fan, to be honest, of Nashville's yellow jersey when it first came in, but it grew on me over time.
Now that they got the bright yellow helmets to go with it, it looks a lot better.
It does, yeah, it looks more put together, but the Oilers one, I think it's just terrible. I'm really hoping that if the NHL ends up redoing all of the jerseys next year like I expect them to. I'm really hoping that we don't end up seeing the Oilers adopting orange as a full-time color.
When I was at the Dome, there was like a group of 10 Oilers fans, and they all had the Pumpkin McDavid jerseys, and it's like, oh, God.
Yeah. Well, you know, I mean, those jerseys died in 74, the orange ones, for a reason.
Like, anytime you're taking fashion tips from the 70s or 80s, just don't.
And I think they'd be a cool outdoor game jersey where it's that throwback. It's like, yeah, okay, we can do this. Sort of like the Flames, what I still think of the ugliest Flames jerseys. They're outdoor game jerseys. But or even do it for one, like, retro night. But otherwise, like, we don't need to see these 15 to 20 games a year. So, anyway, we'll see how the week goes, but I hope that we have a better week for the Flames. Before we go, we want to let everybody know that the new Fireside Chat website is launched. We have it up. We're going to be constantly populating it over the next week with content, getting articles up there, getting some of the news up there, and you'll be seeing some features added over the next couple weeks, so definitely check it out. If you do subscribe to the podcast through the RSS feed, through either your podcast reader or iTunes or something like that, the old feed will work, but what I was finding today is you're getting duplicate episodes. So you'll see two of every episode. So you should still see the new episode show up, but if you want to get the clean version, unsubscribe from the podcast feed, go to the website and go to, under the podcast menu, go to subscribe to the podcast and resubscribe. Use our new podcast feed page. And unfortunately, we had to, just because of the way the new site is architected, we had to change that URL. So it's unfortunate, but it's going to be better for us in the long run.
The new website is a lot more user-friendly, and it'll make it a lot easier for you to subscribe in the manner that you want. A lot easier to get whatever Fireside Chat content that you're looking for.
Yeah, so there's a few growing pains that we're going through. The biggest one I was noticing when we were testing it was just around the, you know, subscribing stuff, and you're going to get duplicates in your feed, but that's something that we can all deal with. We can all work around for sure. And just if it bothers you, or if you're seeing, as some people have reported that they're seeing, hey, I'm seeing all these unread episodes. Don't worry. It's just old episodes that were ported to the new site. So you've already listened to them. Just mark them all as read or whatever it is you do on your device. And over the next couple of weeks, we will be introducing you guys some new features we have. We have, based on feedback from you guys in our listener survey, we have some new features launching. We have ways for you to give us feedback and be part of the show. We're going to have some polls up on the site. So give us just a little bit of time to get everything stabilized and ready to go. And then we will introduce you guys to some of the cool stuff we have planned. Check it out if you haven't seen it. We had some issues with the launch over the weekend, but the new site is there now, so check it out. And like I said, if you want to resubscribe to the podcast feed, you can. Otherwise, the old one will still work. It's just going to look a bit funky for you over the next couple weeks until some of the new episodes start to populate it. And otherwise, we will talk to you guys next week. Have a good week, Matt, and let's hope it's not a total disaster for the Flames.
This show is licensed under Creative Commons license. For full license information, visit firesidechat.ca.